Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, everybody.
Okay, thanks very much.
I'd like to first of all thank Cambridge University Press for bringing me here. And most importantly, I'd like to thank you for your interest in this session. The session is about what I believe is a very important aspect of what Earl Stevig referred to when he said, success in the foreign language class depends less on materials, techniques, and linguistic analysis, and more on what goes on inside and between the people in the classrooms. So, resilience, and this is the topic actually, is, I believe, a very important aspect of that. What I hope to be covering in this session is, first of all, I want to share a definition of positive psychology, because you might ask yourselves, well, is there a negative psychology too, if he's talking about referring to a research from positive psychology, and of course also resilience. And the second point is I will give you a brief summary of some of the references I have used. Sarah spoke quite a lot about resilience in her, Sarah Mercer, in her plenary yesterday, so I will not need to go into research in too much of a detail. And thirdly, I will, and hopefully you will, make some suggestions for classroom application. This is a workshop, so I hope we'll have a nice balance of participation that comes from you and also on of input that comes from me. Let's start with something I have kind of like focused on for the last two or three years, and that is the importance of the students' emotional engagement. Last year, I actually gave a talk on how to, and also the year before, on another aspect of it, on how to engage our students emotionally. And I was talking about positive emotions there. The point I made, and I've given also talks in a number of countries about that, were that, first of all, positive emotional engagement is important because it has a very significant influence on our students' memory, how much they remember of what we are teaching them or what they're doing in the classroom, depends to a certain degree, and I think to a significant degree, on their positive emotional engagement. Secondly, I think it makes our students' learning more relevant to them. And third of all, if they are positively emotionally engaged, it'll foster their sense of ownership of the language they are learning. When I spoke about this kind of positive emotional engagement last year, I had a chat with a colleague afterwards, and she said, you know what, I would like to ask you, what is the role of negative emotions in the language learning process? And I was kind of like, well, let's try to avoid negative emotions. But actually, you know, reading about resilience and reading about some of these very important findings, what's dawned on me is that our students' negative emotions have an important role in a way because, and this is what today's session is all about, they need to learn how to overcome problems. They need to learn how to overcome their perceptions of their maybe lack of competence or what have you. By definition, the process of learning another language will very often give our students experiences of making mistakes, of maybe not you know, being fully competent, etc., etc., etc. And learning to deal with those negative emotions is a very important part of learning languages successfully, I believe. So let's start with the definitions. First of all, a definition of positive psychology that comes from Sarah Mercer's and McIntyre's work. It's the empirical study of how people thrive and flourish. It's the study of the ordinary human strengths and virtues that make life good. And two definitions of resilience. First of all, a dictionary definition. It's the quality of being able to return quickly to previous good condition after problems. And a psychological definition that comes from Rebecca Oxford's work. It's actually from a webinar she did for IATEFL. Some of you may have taken part in that, where she says, resilience is the ability to successfully spring back from adversity. Language learners need resilience in times of emotional, cognitive, and or physical stress. And this is my first task for you. I would like you to turn to the person next to you, or to two or three people next to you, actually, form small groups. And after briefly introducing yourself and maybe giving your colleagues some ideas of the kind of context that you're teaching in, would you please share with each other what you think might cause your students emotional, cognitive, and or physical stress? Can we take 3 or 4 minutes for that, please? Okay, thank you very much. I hope you've had enough time to actually listen to each one in your group. Could I just ask you to call out a few of the things that you have shared in your groups? Sorry? Tests, thank you. Yes.
Classroom peers, friends in the classroom?
The dynamics of the classroom, friends in the classroom, and the kind of pressure, peer group pressure. Okay, thank you. Parents' expectations, thank you. I'm sorry?
The teacher.
What was that?
The teacher.
The teacher, right. Yeah. We are talking, just to make this clear, about those teachers out there, right? Okay. age, okay? So you're thinking of teenagers, right? I can, yeah, okay. I'm sorry, I have to run a bit closer. Self-expectations, and you know, if they set their objectives too high, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, please.
Life experiences.
So their own learner histories, maybe.
And because I work with refugees.
Okay.
So I can see that
right.
Past life affects a lot.
Yeah. The lady is saying she's working with. Sorry for repeating it, but the lady is saying she's working with refugees. So. Their own personal background, their life stories. Yes, thank you.
It's too challenging for them?
If the whatever it is you're doing with them is too challenging, okay. Yes, please.
If it seems too easy for them.
If it's too easy for them, okay. Yep. So we need to find a middle of the road kind of level of challenge, absolutely. Uh-huh. Homesick when they are studying abroad, missing their families, missing their food, maybe. Yeah, that was not about the UK, I apologize.
A sense of shaming by the teacher.
Okay, a sense of shaming by the teacher if the teacher does that, yeah. Again, we are talking about those teachers out there. Okay.
Leave class early because their boss asked okay. to come in earlier.
Yeah. You're talking about university students, adult students.
Years old enough.
Okay. Students who are doing a job and you need to sort of balance their studies with the need to earn money. Okay. Thank you.
Additional learning needs.
Additional learning needs.
Yes.
Can you say more about that?
I have one or two people who have dyspraxia, dyslexia.
Okay.
So it's important to tailor your teaching
okay.
style to the individual, whether of course they have an additional learning need or not. It's
okay.
to personalize the
learning. Okay.
If you don't do that,
okay.
that can cause an awful lot of stress.
Okay, thanks very much. So we could probably go on and find other stress factors too, and there is a short sort of checklist that I have developed over time by talking to colleagues. But certainly language learning is something that does cause or can cause stress for our students too. And how they manage to deal with that stress, I will claim, is a very, very important factor that influences success or failure. Now, what do we know from research? Well, first of all, what we know is that resilience is not something we are born with in terms of it's a fixed kind of factor in our minds. It's actually something that is determined by our mindsets, and it can actually change. It can be influenced. What comes to mind when you look at this?
Sorry.
China, you're saying? I was in China last week, and they said Japan.
India so, as well. India preparing for their exam.
Okay, but apart from the location, and I have really no idea where the photo was taken, is there anything else that comes to mind? Stress, exams,
deadlines.
Boredom. Okay. Sorry? Same. Okay. Well, I mean, the key point here is that as far as research into resilience goes, it's never the situation as such that is stressful. It's how people react to a certain situation. I mean, this, I think, is a quotation that makes this clear. In challenging situations, entity theorists, that's people who have a theory that they have a certain lack of capability, or they lack certain capabilities. So they have a fixed mindset as Sarah called that in her plenary yesterday. Those entity theories among our students who interpret failures as a sign that they lack the ability to learn react in a more helpless-oriented manner. They showed in that study a greater anxiety and avoidance, higher dropout rate, and deterioration in performance. In contrast, incremental theorists, so people who believe that capabilities are not fixed, that they can actually develop, interpret failures as a sign that they need to expend more time, more effort, could also be time, of course, to improve. So the key point here is that it's never the situation as such. It is actually how people react to the one and same situation. So different people might react totally differently in the same situation, depending on their beliefs about the situation, about themselves, about their capabilities, about their teacher, about their classmates, etc., etc., etc. Carol Dweck uses the term fixed mindsets and growth mindsets rather than entity theorists and incremental theorists. And what she says is that fixed mindsets are basically about I am or I have. I am hopeless when it comes to grammar. I have a good knowledge of lexis, etc., etc., etc. While as the growth mindset sees learning as something that happens as we go along, and we can actually influence this learning process by learning and by growing actually ourselves. This is Carol Dweck. This growth mindset is based on the belief that your quality, that your basic qualities are things you can cultivate through your efforts. Although people may differ in every which way in their initial talents and aptitudes, interests, or temperaments, everyone can change and grow through application and experience. And that's a key point. Do people with this mindset believe that anyone can be anything? With proper motivation or education can become Einstein or Beethoven? No. But they believe that a person's true potential is unknown and unknowable. That it's impossible to foresee what can be accomplished with years of passion, toil, and training. And this gentleman has to say something important about these possible mindsets too. That's what he says in Hamlet, actually. Thinking makes it so. I have a short extract that comes from a very wise woman. Actually, it was a 9-year-old learner in an Austrian classroom. Some of you may have seen this because I really love sharing this quotation. It was a little girl who, you know, the kind of learner we would love to have hundreds of in our classrooms. She was not only extremely motivated, I think she was the best student in the class, and she just loved learning, and she had this incredible capability to, without any effort, remember things she heard her teacher say. She was this risk taker also. She heard her teacher use chunks of language. And then, you know, 5 or 10 minutes later, she just tried using the same chunks, you know? And I held an interview with her, and I wanted to know from her what kind of beliefs she had about herself in moments when she got stuck, when she didn't remember things. And this is what she said. I carried the interview out in German. I translated it into English. I said, okay, let's say you can't remember a word or a phrase, even if you try very hard. What do you do then? And at this point, she laughed and said, that doesn't matter. And I thought, what's going on there? You know, it doesn't matter what you mean. She said, well, it doesn't matter if I can't do it now. Yeah, then I just tell myself one day I'll be able to do it. It doesn't matter that I'm not able to do it now yet. One day I'll be able to do it. I'm sure I will. Isn't this a lovely belief to have in a moment of learning failure? Isn't this exactly the kind of belief we would like to take on board when we get stuck, this nine-year-old girl? And in fact, Carol Dweck talks about, Sarah mentioned this yesterday in her plenary, she talks about the power of yet. And this is what Barbara, what's her name, actually says here. Quotation from Benjamin Barber, very inspiring, I think. We have a problem, don't we, when we have learners in our classrooms who are non-learners. And the key point is whether they are or are learners or non-learners, actually. Second one, mindsets are flexible and they can change. We can help our students modify them. This is from a recent study by Lou and Noels. It's possible to change how people think about their nature of language aptitude and thereby influence their language motivation. These findings highlight the dynamic and situated nature of mindsets. Third one, those of you who have an interest in neurobiology, our prefrontal cortex, the part of the brain that is first of all, from an evolutionary point of view, the youngest part of the human brain, the part of the brain that is responsible for critical thinking, all kind of higher order thinking capabilities. This part of the brain plays a key role in the development of resilience, the frontal lobe. Most people, many people I've spoken to about this, think that prefrontal cortex activity is only about intellectual things. But actually, neurobiologists say that there is no real separation in the brain between highly sort of like challenging and demanding cognitive activity and emotions. Actually, people like Lasseras and Lasseras say we are very emotional animals, and thinking is always connected to emotions. And actually, the prefrontal cortex has very clear links with our emotional systems. So what we see from research is that the prefrontal cortex also integrates thinking and emotions, integrates life experiences, as one colleague said, experiences from the past, present, and future to create a coherent narrative of who we are and how our life makes sense. I think this is an important point. Learning will only be successful for our students if it does make sense to them. Learning, and especially motivation, are not, you know, about a fireworks of activities that help our students to enjoy and have fun. I found this quotation very useful. This comes from a website on resilience. I think the colleague is teaching in Japan, actually. And he says, if we do want to forge perseverant and resilient learners, we must be mindful of the effect of overly spoon-feeding and entertaining them with games, wow-inducing app-smashing and other gimmicks, which encourage a misconception of what language learning is really about. I have bolded the next sentence. In order to become resilient, our students must be made aware of and experience the challenges and inevitable setbacks that language learning entails, whilst feeling part of a safe, supportive, and empathetic learning environment where errors are tolerated or even encouraged. And I like this quotation, James Geard. It's not about fun. It is about a serious activity. This is very interesting. This Jeremy, I think, is very much in line with the discussion we've had recently about stories and the use of stories in the classroom going so much beyond, you know, just teaching language, really. Stories are about making sense of our experiences, and making sense of the world in many ways for our students. There are studies, recent studies into resilience, that actually show that the use of stories can have a very, very important impact on the development of students' resilience. Two quotations here. They actually worked with adult students, if I remember correctly, and they say several types of stories predicted noteworthy correlations in resilience measured by the storytelling survey. The results indicated that recalling the stories of childhood, I find this extremely interesting, helps adults cope with the struggles of learning a second language. This was significantly positively related to most types of stories. And of course, when you think of the stories children love, when you think of the fairy tales in many cultures and in many countries around the world, they're never just entertaining. Kieran Egan, who was one of our plenary speakers years ago, said, you know, stories are important because they actually help develop the personalities of the learners. And many stories are about huge, big human qualities and values, really. And it's not only about the stories from our childhood. It's also about getting them to discuss and share stories of how they have overcome language learning problems, their struggles that they have gone through. So this is I think, of very direct value to our teaching, what they have found here. And this is where I would like to start, actually, suggestions for classroom application. And I would actually like to start with using stories, really. I would like to use a story that I have used quite often in teenage classrooms. And that's a story, it's a real story, it's a true story about a woman, some of you may have come across the story, a woman called Phoebe Schnetzinger. When she was 50 years old, she had two children, two grown-up children. She was diagnosed with cancer. And the doctors, I think, gave her six months, half a year, or 10 months, or something like that. And she came to this decision that she said, well, if I have another half a year to live, what I want to do is I want to do something that I've always wanted to do, but I never had the time to do. And that passion was bird watching. So she started going on journeys to far-flung places, and she became a very, very dedicated bird watcher. Interestingly, at the age of 61, so 11 years later, she was still alive, obviously, and she had become one of the world's most successful bird watchers. I think she had spotted an incredible number of 7,600 and something birds. Then her cancer came back. And again, she said, no, I'm not going to give up what I love doing. And she started traveling again. She continued with her bird watching. And this is a photo of her. And this is bird number 8,400 she saw, the rufous necked wood rail. I read it's a very rare bird. So if you've never seen this, this is the reason why. Ironically, she died, I think, at the age of 68 when she was on the island of Madagascar. She was bird watching, and it was actually a car accident. She was run over by a lorry while she was bird watching in Madagascar. But it's the kind of story that some people think, well, this is not teenage enough. It doesn't have this wow effect. It doesn't have the glitz and glamour of the film industry or the pop industry or the content that some people think teenagers are so interested in. When I've used this story with teenagers, it's always led to good discussions and a lot of thinking, actually. She wrote, and this book was published by the American Association of Birdwatchers, I believe. She wrote a beautiful book, very moving book, called Birding on Borrowed Time. Can I please ask you to think for a moment? And maybe you are now thinking, well, I really can't think of a resilience story. But maybe you will think and remember a resilience story. It can be a general one, such as the one about Phoebe Snetzinger. But it could also be a story about resilience in language learning. Maybe about one of your students, but maybe also about yourself. Can I just ask you to think for a moment and then have a chat with another person or, you know, two or three people next to you. Story about resilience. Okay, I'm aware I am interrupting some of you. Apologies. We can definitely not listen to all the stories, but could I just ask maybe two or three of you to give us a a short version of your story, please, the one you found? Anybody interested? This was the moment when the seminar workshop broke down. Yes, Cecilia, I'm coming with the mic.
Okay.
Fine motor skills, so he had to stop playing, and that was his life. So he became a conductor, and then he was in a car accident, if I'm not mistaken, and he lost his movements in one of his hands.
Wow.
And he found a way to conduct using only one of the hands. So for me, that's a very nice story to use.
Powerful. Thank you very much. Thank you. Was that a sign? No. Where? Okay. Who was it? Sorry, can I?
Over here.
David. Thank you.
Yeah, 2 days ago, I was doing a resilience activity. I was doing a told a tale of injustice and asked students to talk about a tale of injustice of their experience in groups. One student, a young woman in South Korea, told us that she had been to London recently and gone to pay in a restaurant, and when she'd gone to pay, she was told by that person, I don't know if it was the waiter, that she had to pay extra because she wasn't a British citizen. And she was angry, she argued, and then she left without paying the extra charge. And she became quite emotional telling this story in the class, and the activity was, let's talk about the ending we would have liked to have. And another student suggested that she write an online review about that, and she was unsure about doing that. That was just before I came here on Monday, so next week when I see her, I'm going to find out whether what she's interested in doing for the next step. But I find this process very interesting.
Right. Thank you. Unfortunately, we haven't got the time to go into this further. I would have also liked to hear some of the I hope there must have been some language learning resilience stories too. And that is something I think that we could actually start collecting together with our students, you know, resilience stories about language learning. The next suggestion I would like to make is actually encouraging students to explore the values that are in these stories, not just actually to share the stories, but to get them to share their own perception of what the power of those stories actually is. Students need help if we want them to engage in this. This is a suggestion, just a few tips. We could ask them, for example, to think about we could present them with a number of value statements, ask them what they think about those, get them to compare their findings, and to encourage them to rank order them, to actually say which of these values are important to them. I think what is important for us here as teachers is that we are non-judgmental about those processes. This would be an example. When you think of the Phoebe Snetzinger story, value statements would be things like being passionate about things you like, it's extremely important. A hobby you like, you really like, can have a positive effect on your health, etc., etc., etc. Get them to tick the statements they agree with, get them to talk about those statements with a partner, get them to then rank order the ones or kind of like pick the ones that are most important for them. Next suggestion is about positive information, feedback, something that Sarah also mentioned in her session yesterday. This is an example that comes from No, this is a quotation or a reference that comes from Zoltán Dörner's work. And the example, actually, I find this example wonderful, comes from Jim Scrivener's classroom management book, where he gives examples of this descriptive, informative feedback. It's not that easy. We have to really, I think, practice giving this kind of feedback. Many colleagues initially think, well, I want to give positive feedback. But then positive feedback, if it's not done in the right way, can actually sometimes, you know, not really create the effects we want. So here he says, for example, about a story that a student has written. I really enjoyed reading this story. The part about swimming made me laugh out loud. So the teacher reacting emotionally to part of the content of the student has written. Or this one, I saw you working really hard to find the answers, but I'm afraid these four are wrong. What help can I give you to make the task clearer? This is, I think, beautiful because it has this yet, this power of yet belief ingrained in this. Two more examples from here. And the last point I would like to briefly mention is showing our students that we take their emotions seriously, which is, I think, something we can all agree on, and we will nod our heads. But it's not always easy to do, actually, because there are times when we are stressed too. It's not that we are always in our top form when a student says something which is negative. I mean, for example, if a student says, we've got a math test next week, and now you're giving us so much homework. How do you react? Okay, no homework would be one way. So for time reasons, we're not going to do a task here, unfortunately. It would have been interesting to see the various suggestions. A few suggestions here. Well, this is how some of us, or those teachers out there, will react, okay? You should have started studying for that test earlier. Then the homework I'm giving you wouldn't be any problem whatsoever, okay? But that's not exactly taking students' emotions seriously, I think you would agree. I'm drawing the examples I'm giving now, they're actually examples I have created. But they are influenced by an extremely useful book I found extremely useful. That is a book by Faber and Maslisch, and it's actually, the title of the book is How to Talk So Teens Will Listen and How to Listen So Teens Will Talk. I think it's a lovely title, and it's a very, very good book. I think Adrian Underhill, for many years, always stressed the importance of the teacher actually listening to the students in the right way. So one option would be identifying thoughts and feelings. So the student is saying, we've got a math test next week, and now you're giving us so much homework. The teacher could say, sounds like you're pulled in two directions. You want to make sure you write a good math test, but you also don't want to disappoint me by not doing the homework I've just given you. One possible option. Option two, give in fantasy what you can't give in reality. Phew, we've got a math test next week and now you're giving us so much homework. Yeah, I know. Wouldn't it be great if I'd never had to set any homework? You would think I'm the world's best teacher. This kind of like opens up the students', I think, minds in a way so that you can talk about these things with them and take them seriously. Or option three, if you were me, okay? We've got a math test next week, and now you're giving us so much homework. I can hear what you're saying, and I understand you. I wonder what you would say if you were me. Put yourselves into my shoes. Think about the situation from the teacher's point of view. And I think there's a fourth, which comes from Faber and Maslisch, and that is acknowledging feelings with a word or sound. Of course, what is important here is not only the word or the sound, but but what is behind there in terms of the teacher's attitude. It needs to be a supportive attitude, definitely. Okay, I'd like to finish off with a quotation that comes from L. Stevick. And he says, these then are two dimensions within which you will be of greater or less help to your students, developing their communicative competence and perfecting their linguistic competence. There is, however, a third dimension without which these first two can lead at best to an academic flat, sterile achievement. The question is whether as teacher or how much as teacher we can hope to help our students in this third dimension. I'm not sure, but let me set before you briefly what I see here. The third competence is personal. Okay, thanks very much. Thank you.